the book on user interface design, which I never wrote, but imagine I had, would in chapter number one say, make sure your user interface can be used without a mouse. In this episode, I'll show you two tools to get your user interface more non-mouse friendly. The first tool in the toolbox for making your application more keyboard friendly is Accelerators. You saw that in the main window already, where the F had an underscore or a line under it in the file for the file dialog. And when you opened up the file dialog, save had an underscore or a line under it for S, which meant that you could press Alt F to bring up the file dialog, Alt S. I don't know why I need to look down on my keyboard to be able to say Alt S, but Alt S for saving. You can do the same thing with other parts of your user interface, and let me show you that. So imagine here in this user interface at regular expression that we have decided that the R should be one of those in S, and then you see the ampersand in front of R makes that one selected. And case sensitive, that would maybe be C, I don't know. And finally, whole words, well, could be any of those W's, so let's just go with the first one. And now when I run my application, go and close that one, and I bring up SCF. Unfortunately, there wasn't one for E, but now we are. And here you can see Alt C, and it toggles this one here. Alt R toggles this one. Alt W doesn't do anything. And you hear me press it, doesn't do anything because the object is disabled. Now it's enabled, and now LW will, well, it'll toggle and print out. But what about search up here? It would be nice if I could start searching by pressing Alt S. Well, we used S down here, didn't we? See Rs? No, we didn't. So Alt S, that would be useful. Let me try and put an ampersand in front of that. And let me just take the focus rectangle away, and you can see it says ampersand there still. There is no line underneath it. That's because that the label there do not take any focus. But what you can do is that you can say, well, the label will give focus to something else if it gets a focus. And for that, we'll go up here and choose the edit bodies here, except that the Qt company managed to switch these two around, so I'll take this one, but sure, in your user interface, you're choosing this one. Now I'll say, whenever this one gets focused, it should give it to this one. And notice how the S got underlined, and let me run the application now. And when it hits search, well, it had focus there, but I can give focus to this one down there by pressing Alt R and now Alt S, and you can see the cursor started blinking there, so it got focus back into that one.
Didn't we fix that bug last month? And now it reappeared?
Have you heard your boss say that? Well, if that's the case, maybe, just maybe, you're not testing your software thoroughly enough. One of those solutions for testing is called Squish. It's a black box testing tool, and the cool thing about that is that we can help you there too, both with training and setting up your basic test infrastructure. The other thing that can make your application more keyboard friendly is to set up a good tab order. That way, the user can just fill in something, press tab to go to the next field, press tab to go to the next field, and so on. And usually, your user would expect it to be Y, X as a sorting, so something that is higher up on the screen is met before, and something that is more to the left is met before something on the same Y coordinate. Let me show you how you set up tab order inside of Qt Creator, but also do not kill the messenger because it is a bit of a mess. Tab order in Qt, that is, not just inside of Qt Designer. What I need to do is to go and choose this icon up here, edit tab order. Now what I do, you can see the tab order here was somewhat random. Well, it was the order in which I created the widgets. We first talked about these things here, and then I added Perl and Seed later on. So that made that order. But let's add something here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And that's the tab order. If I run my application now, it hits search, then I'm here. I go down there. I can use the keyboard to select this. I go down here into the radio button, but now I jumped out. And that actually took me a while to realize that the tab order set up inside of Qt Creators do not understand that radio buttons behave as one group. So let me press Shift Tab to go up here, and you can see now with my arrow up and arrow down key, I choose which one I want. So I cannot go outside. I'm pressing arrow down. I cannot go back up. I'm pressing arrow up, but I can press Tab to go to the next thing. So again, type something here. Something. Go over here, say that I want regular expression or not. Go over here and disable. And let me just go back here and say I do not want. Then you can see it actually, as it should, jumps over the deselected widgets. Now, jumping again, it'll pass by the whole words and go straight to close. As you can see, it's the one with the current focus. That's a blue rectangle outline there. Pressing Tab will get me to search, and pressing Tab again will get me back up to the beginning. Okay, so I shouldn't have been able to select both of the radio buttons is to be in that tab order group, only one of them, because they were in a radio button selection mode. That was one of the surprising things in here. The other surprising thing is that if I go back up here now and I add a new tool button or a new checkbox, I have no idea what that would be about, but let's just call it checkbox, put it into the layout. Let's resize the window here so it's a good size again, and so on. Go to the tab order, and you can see the new one got into that order here. That is likely not what I want, and I need to go again and say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and so on. And doing this all the time is just very cumbersome. I actually solved that problem, let me see, almost 20 years ago in my hobby project, an open source application called KPhotoAlbum. And what I do there is that whenever the user is, or whenever the window is shown, so in the show event, I will call a function for setup tab order. It will search for all the children, and those children will then be sorted according to their Y, X. That would work for all those situations where that is what I want. Of course, there could be situations where that is not where what I want, that I want to go somewhere completely different based on the setup of the application. But in that situation, well, that's the corner case I'll play. There is a link right here into that video where I start talking about it. But I actually urge you to start from the beginning, because I start explaining the code that does this by showing an old version of the code and then showing a new version where I have rewritten the new version to use algorithms, more specifically a library that I've created called Qt Algorithms that makes that code actually very nice. Look in the description below. I might actually make this into more than just an example from Qt Widgets and more, and if I do so, there's going to be a link below that tells you where to find that finely polished code. As I said, this code was written 20 years ago to solve a very specific use case I had back then. That's it for this episode. Accelerators and tab orders. Do get them right, unless you hate your users. And let me give you a free advice here. As a developer, learn the shortcuts yourself of your favorite tools. I cannot emphasize enough how much more efficient you are with, say, Qt Creator if you do not need to grab for the mouse all the time, but can simply just press magic keys on your keyboard to get what you want. Anyway, that's it for this episode. Thank you very much for watching, and until next time, have a great time.